Never try to be better than someone else. Always learn from others. And never cease trying to be the best you could be. That's under your control.
Anybody can be a coach, and a good coach can coach anything.
This kid's gonna be the best kid in the world. This kid's gonna be somebody better than anybody ever knew.
The mindset of a coach can belong to anyone.
And when you get to the point where all you want to do is be successful, as bad as you want to breathe, then you'll be successful. Pain is temporary.
They ask me why I teach, and I reply, where could I find such splendid company?
Welcome to the fourth episode of the Coaching Mindset Podcast. I am Liam O'Neill, the Prove It Guy.
And I'm Gary Wallace from Core NI. And today we're going to talk about changes.
And the fact that changes are good and how people should be willing to change. Mix up their routine, mix up their daily life. Do you think it should be a daily thing, or do you think it should be like one a week?
The key word and everything, it all depends.
Yeah.
It depends on the person. If you feel that you need a change, or even more importantly, if you want to change, then find the area you need to change at. As I say, this all came about from, I just got a text message last Friday night to see about doing a duathlon on a Sunday morning.
What is a duathlon?
So a duathlon, for this one, we were up in Ancraig, and it was the Oma Tri Club. And what we did, we ran 5K in the snow, by the way.
Yeah.
Cycled 10K on a mountain bike around the tracks up there, and then finished with a 3.5K run. So any duathlon is normally a run, bike, run. You're really taking out the swim of the triathlon. Now, for all those tri people out there, I don't know if you can mix it up if it's a swim run or a bike swim as well. But normally, I think that they're normally like a...
They can contact us and tell us. So
yeah, you can contact us.
If we're wrong, it's because we don't know, not because...
But that was my whole change. We went in to try and do something different. It was a whole field that I didn't know nothing about. It was a friend of mine, Decky Campbell, at Raw Performance. Check him out. Top guy. So he texted, we were in a training group, and he texted us. This was a bit awkward when I was saying this earlier, because Liam's not in that training group. But
because I don't exercise, supposedly.
We'll add Liam into that training group. But anyway, Decky texted, and just literally says, yeah, why not? Because I felt it would just change up my whole training routine of, at the moment, it's getting into the gym, it's get myself ready for a new football season. But this was totally different. And I just said, yeah, go for it. And had a mountain bike there, and just went up on the Sunday morning and absolutely smashed it. Great. Well, not smashed it, but I enjoyed it.
So you're saying that people, if they think they need a change, then it doesn't have to be as dramatic as running in the snow like Rocky IV. But it can be anything. You can just change up like what you're eating. You can change up anything. I think it's important to notice too, if you don't think you need a change, then you definitely do. Like if you're doing your day to day and everything's going perfectly and you think everything's normal, you definitely need to mix it up. Because you don't know what you're missing. You don't know, like what we talked about training before, that if you're training a certain way and you think it's going really well, for all you know, you mixing up and adding in a different exercise or taking a different break period between like strength work, maybe that will improve it even more without you having to think about it. So some people, I think, just get caught in a rut, but they don't know they're in a rut. So then they don't feel they need a change because life's fine. But
yeah.
I don't think life is designed to be fine. I think you can make it awesome. So one of the, just whenever you're saying that you took on a challenge, one of the challenges I took on once was agreeing to sail a boat from Carrickfergus to Plymouth after only ever being on a P&O ferry.
That doesn't count, by the way, really.
I know it doesn't count. The boat was a 37-foot yacht, and it was supposed to take us 4 days, and everything that went wrong could have went wrong, and it ended up taking us 9 days. So I ended up living on a boat, and I'm quite a healthy eater. Like, but when I was on this boat, I was eating salty digestive biscuits for 3 days because that's all we had left after the oven went on fire. There's a wee tiny oven that went on fire. It was good.
What was this for, sorry?
This was just to deliver. It was just delivering a boat. I got asked when I was teaching Tai Chi one morning, would I be up for doing it? They said they didn't need anyone that has any idea about boating. They just need someone that's fit enough to survive. And I agreed and then never met any of the people on the boat before.
The crew
is what they're called. And the next Friday, they just, one of them lifted me, Andy, the boatman. That's what I always called him. He has a second name, but I've always called him Andy, the boatman. They lifted me from Tai Chi and drove me straight to Carrickfergus. I'd never even been in Carrickfergus before.
Yeah.
So I lived in a boat for 9 days. But what it did for me, it was about, I think it was about 8 years ago. Anything now I ever have to do is never as hard as that in my mind. So anytime I'm any challenge is given to me or anything that I just undertake, I just think it's not 9 days on a boat. Like that boat was, yeah, like it was brutal. Like you're sitting in the middle of the ocean at night. Like, and I hadn't slept for about, I don't know, about 4 days at a point. Like I tried to go to sleep one time and thought I was going to die downstairs, whatever the downstairs bit's called. The living quarters, I'll call it.
The bit that, yeah. I don't know where
you're at. Any boat folk can also send me the information. I don't actually care. So I don't need to know that information. It's not important. But now when I go to do anything, like whenever I went with Shane Mullen, who was doing running, he ran. I had to drive with him for 18 hours. And people were like, how could you do that? It's like mentally tough. And I was thinking the whole time, it's only 18 hours and I could drive home at any moment. It's not 9 days on a boat. So whenever you hit a challenge, it can make everything else easier. So then you can create more and more challenges. But just like you would have noticed it at the weekend, the thrill and the feel for how you feel about yourself after you do something that you not necessarily thought you couldn't do, but you knew was going to be hard, just to know that you can go through tough times that you create yourself. So then whenever there is tough times in your life, you have that sort of resilience there to maintain it.
Yeah, I think it's that thing about whenever people change or do something, anything that they want to change, is that fear.
Yeah,
because it was on the Saturday, I was ringing Decky and he goes, oh, are we still up for this? And I was like, yeah, I am. He goes, well, I don't know. I was just hoping maybe it might be off or something. He would loved it whenever we did it. It was great. But it was just that sense of maybe we should do this another time, or just getting over that initial, it wasn't really fear. It was a wee bit of
lack of preparation.
Yeah, probably. But we went up and literally I went up and I did the whole thing and all the pictures that were taken of me, I was smiling. I absolutely loved it. It was just, I went up there with an open mindset. When I landed, the atmosphere and everything was really good. It's a great club. You'd be surprised when you go up, the amount of people you actually know.
Yeah.
And we're going along and we're just chatting and everybody's so helpful. You know, have you thought you could try this or don't worry about this. And it was just very relaxed. And then
handling like Vaseline and all.
Yeah, well, we didn't have to do any of that. Didn't that part.
What about your nips?
didn't go that far, so I didn't. Jeez, they had no time to harden up, so they didn't. So, what happened then, I was just felt easy running. I wasn't the strongest in the bike, but even then too, when we went up there and I was worried about, I didn't know what the snow or anything was going to be like, but in actual fact, oh, actually probably, I was going to get all corny here, but it was absolutely beautiful. You know, you were coming around the corner and it was just blue skies and the sun was coming out. It's just as if you were somewhere skiing.
Yeah.
And it was only 15 minutes up the road. The way I thought about it was, I had the duathlon done, so what, that's 8.5k run and a 10k cycle in total. And I had my wee tea and scone, and I actually won a box of Galaxy sweets as well. But I was home for 12 o'clock on a Saturday. And for me, it was like that small change to my Sunday morning routine. I was like, it's 12 o'clock.
Yeah.
I have a whole day here, and I've already accomplished that. Just by literally saying, yeah, you know what, I'll give that a go. I'll change up my routine, my training routine.
So for coaches, whenever we're talking to the coaches we work with, them changing up their routine will keep, to me, it keeps their students or their clients or whoever's coming to train under them more engaged. Like they're not coming every week going, oh, I hate Tuesdays because I know we have burpee Tuesdays and we do this and this. They're coming and they have to like have an open mind because they might end up doing completely different exercises. And that would, for the client and the student, will keep them more engaged, but also for the, as a coach, you learn so much more about your the people that you work with whenever you put them through different challenges, but you learn so much about yourself as well, because you might set up a challenge, realize halfway through that actually this challenge is really difficult for these people, I need to change. So then you start to learn to think on your feet. So I think it's important as coaches or people that teach people, or even like whenever we say coaches, we mean everyone who can teach anything. So whenever you have a parent, if you have a parent that's trying to get their child to do a certain thing, like go to school or eat their dinner or eat a breakfast or something, if you change up, even it might be as simple as giving them a different plate or giving them it at a different time, or just the way you talk to them about the dinner that you're presenting. We've talked before about if your kid wants to be a footballer, or you find out who their favourite footballer is, and then instead of explaining that this is vegetables and it's going to make you strong and you have to eat that, you would say, this is the type of dinner that I always go to Ronaldo. It's the only footballer I can remember that exists. So you changing that up and changing the routine of the people around you as well can just reignite people, I think, instead of them being just used to going from A to B to C.
No, definitely. And even when I go back to when I'm coaching, even my boot camps and classes, I would nearly always change it up, but I would still have the same principles as such.
Yeah.
I would have, you know, my compound lifts in, but if we were doing a circuit at the end, or we'd mix it up and do some form of like extreme, like tempo running or whatever it may be, but it's still the core of it's there. The, you know, you've got your deadlifts, you've got your squats, you've got your push, you've got your pull, you've got your hinge. It's there, but everything around it kind of changes up, because it keeps me as well too excited. Makes me go and look at new exercises, try things out. And the other thing is too, is I could try to come up with this exercise or seen it somewhere and try it out with the boot campers and go, nah, that just didn't work. Or that didn't work for me. So what? At least I know that that's not working. Mm-hmm. So I'll change and try and do something else as well. And that's the biggest thing I think you get from whenever you change something up, is you're either going to learn, okay, that works, or it doesn't suit me, or it might not suit me at this time, or I have to keep trying at it and keep going and keep going. And then eventually you'll find it, well, it does actually work, or it doesn't again. So after that, just go to the next thing to change.
I like whenever you find something that people can do, whenever you just invent something yourself, knowing you're just in the middle. Like I always leave 15 minutes of my classes for play. And it's either I come up with a movement that I'm going to get them to try to do, like transition from one move to another, and just see what they come up with. So they may come up with some nice wee flow drill by themselves, because their body works a different way to get there. Or you might think, well, it's not going to work for him, but at least he'll know his shoulders are tight. And then you see how his body cheats to get there. And then you can work with that. So then you know, right, we need to work on the shoulders or the hips or whatever. And then in about 3 weeks, you can call back. Remember the day we tried to do that and none of you could do it? Or remember the day we tried to do that and it was really difficult? Do it now and you'll notice how easier it is, because we've worked on opening the shoulders or something like that. But just for the mental aspect as well, whenever, like we talked about failure before, whenever you throw random things that they're not expecting, you're going to get people to fail. But when they fail often and you're able to give them positive feedback as to why they failed and how they failed, they're able to grow from the failure. So they're, instead of just feeling, oh, I couldn't do 50 burpees in 2.5 minutes or however long you want it to be, but you said the reason you couldn't is because you're using the same leg as you jump back all the time. Either use both legs or alternate legs. Then they've learned from that failure. So you're teaching them again that take ownership of the failure and go on. So then, like, I have students that'll come to me, whereas when I started and I didn't focus too much on the failure and stuff, people wouldn't be able to do stuff. They wouldn't understand, like when I started the martial arts, they wouldn't understand how to do the move or the kata or the form. But they wouldn't ask me because they didn't want to seem like they were failing. They'd try to work it out themselves. So it would slow up their progression. Whereas whenever you teach people that failure's good and like this mightn't work and we're going to do this and this didn't work because of X, Y, and Z, then they grow from that, and then they're able to come to you then when they say at home, oh, I was trying this. Like it's amazing whenever people come to you after you've tried two transitions and they couldn't get one, and they come back the next week going, oh, look, I did this at home and I managed to do... So that they're... Whenever going back to the field, you're creating a habit of understanding what your body does, what your mind does, and how you can improve it yourself. And then you're teaching them how to develop and learn from from their failure. So everything that we've talked about so far in previous podcasts, you can make that just part of daily life in general.
You can kind of see that anything we will talk about and we continue to talk about, it'll all have that crossover.
Yeah,
it's the same with anything, you know, any podcast I listen to, if it's around a certain topic, you'll get that crossover, and but you'll keep getting those spark of new ideas. It's like we were speaking earlier about one of my changes was, well, recently I've just left and went full time, so I left full time employment. So now I'm fully self employed. So but again, that was a change for me, and the fear of failure and everything that came along with my new habits, my new routines, now that I have all from that change, was a big bonus for me, I think, because it made me think about really what I wanted to do, and I wanted to specialize in coaching kids, and I feel I can make a business, I can make a living, I can live the life I want, literally from coaching kids. Not only like the enjoyment and passion and everything I have for it, but I feel that there's a financial pathway for me to go. Whereas beforehand, like when I was working way at the start, when I started up, it was core physio and fitness. My classes were brilliant, really, really good. I loved them. I got a buzz. And financially, I was very well off, but I just got a bit stale. And I felt I needed a change. So what I actually did is I went then and started working for the underage international squads at the IFA. Literally, the money, I wasn't making as much money. I was traveling a lot more. I was up and down the road to Cookstown on a Monday, Wednesday, and on a Sunday as well. And whenever you're training at this time of the year or coaching at this time of year, it can be pretty cold. But it's what I wanted to do. And it's a change I made. I left something behind that was, yes, one of my goals is to be financially secure. And I was leaving all that behind because I knew that this is what I wanted to do. And now, thankfully, I can see now a pathway for me to go. So making that change away from doing classes and doing just really focusing on the personal training side of it.
Mm.
I thought, this is my passion. It's kids. It's coaching kids, it's inspiring, it's being in that team environment. I still love my classes. I love, that's why people say, oh, you don't have that many people. I think the people who turn up are the ones that I really enjoy coaching, because those are the ones, like all the boot campers, everybody that comes to circuit class. I might run a class and might only be one or two people there. I'm like, are you sure you want me to stay? I said, yeah, this is the time I set up. You've made the effort to come out.
Yeah.
So I'm willing to coach you. And when then the other side then is whenever the joy I get out of that, but the enjoyment too I get out of seeing kids do well and inspire, I was like, well, that's where I want to go. That's me. So that change got me to there. Sorry, right, long way of saying that. I kept going and going and going, but the passion was kind of coming out of me. But
I think you made a very good point. One of your goals is to be financially stable. Like, I work with a lot of people and they've got dreams and aspirations, and they want to be personal trainers, or they want to be pole instructors, or they want to be designers or graphic designers or whatever, but they think the passion's enough. Passion is enough, like, if you just want to do this but not make a living from it. Because whenever you just deal with your passion, I think you have to have passion, but you have to be a business person as well. Like, you have to think about yourself financially. I can't maintain what I'm doing if I'm not making enough money to survive. And then if I have to go back to working a normal job, like a 9-to-5 or working back in a bar or something like that, then my whole focus isn't on what I'm doing. Like I was talking to someone yesterday that was doing a 9-to-5, but they have a job like ours where they want to improve that, but they're holding on to the security. And I asked them then, what did you do today that would improve your ability to teach what you want to teach? And they were like, well, nothing. I've no time. I was working. Whereas I sat and reread two of the books that I'm working through, just in case I missed anything from them. And then I did some training, and then I sent some emails and watched a couple of videos on PTSD, mindset for PTSD, things like that, because that's what I want to do. So I spend my time. I might still work a 9-to-5, but it's on what I want to do rather than that. So whenever people don't look at, like, they look at people and think that, oh, he's just in it for the money, but I know that people aren't in it for the money, just the money, because you couldn't do this just for the money. Like, mm-hmm. The money is not going to be enough for you to overlook if you didn't want to do it. Like, that's like you said, you changed what you were doing because you felt like you were stagnating. If it was just the money, you would have just stayed because there's plenty of money in it. So whenever people make a change, they have to think about financially as well. So if you're going to open up a studio or a gym or whatever, it's still a business. At the end of the day, it's a business. You can be as passionate as you want about it, but if that passion gets killed by the fact that you're worrying about money all the time, you're worrying about bills, like you're saying, two people come into your class, if it was just about money, you'd be thinking, well, this doesn't even cover the hall.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to be stuck here. Whereas whenever it's more financially viable and you've thought about all avenues, the two people that come in, you're thinking, especially when they come in and weathered like this, you'd be thinking, yeah, right, these two actually enjoy my class. So it's a privilege to teach those sort of people because you know they're doing it not because they have to, but because they want to be there.
Yeah, definitely. It is that, I think you made a point too. If you do have that passion and you want to make a change, even ask yourself, what's the one thing I did today to get me closer to my goal, to my passion of where I want to be? And I think it's a valid point that you can have all the passion in the world, but you make it a business. Make it your life. That why not earn money? If that's your goal, I know we've talked about this before, maybe it's not high up on your agenda, but it is mine. Everybody's different. But I want to be financially secure that I can take a few months off in the summer to spend time with my son. I know that I can head away on weekends and, you know, live a bit of life of luxury. Yeah. You know, it's not going to be going around throwing money, but it's to get me to a point where I'm doing something I truly believe in. And I'm making money out of it, and that's just going to keep me happy and going to hopefully make me a lot more money too.
I always asked clients that I work with whenever I'm working with them to create their business, when can you retire? Like, if you're a masseuse and you're only working enough to cover yourself and you love massage, and so you let some people away without paying you, and you let some people cheaper, but it's the only income that you have. At some point, your body's going to run out of strength. You're going to run out of the ability to do that. Then how are you going to retire? Like, if you've no nest egg, if you've nothing built up, or if you have children, how are you going to be able to spend time with them? Like, I know some people that work, same as I did in the bars, like, you're working up to 12 hours a day. Yes, you're working 12 hours doing what you love, but if you're not making it financially secure, then eventually that's going to become an issue. So, like you're saying about wanting to take holidays, like Tim Ferriss talks about it, where you do mini retirements.
Yeah.
Like, why save all your money until you retire when you're too old to actually take advantage of it? You should work enough that you get enough money that you can do a mini retirement and, like, take 2 months off just to chill out with your kid, or take a couple of weeks off to go traveling or something like that. But if you think it's just, like, you can't think about finance, it just has to be passion, then it's not going to work out in the long run. Something's going to have to give.
Yeah.
Like, if an unexpected bill comes in, like if your car breaks down, are you thinking, geez, now I have to do 10 extra hours this week to cover the car? Or are you able to just delve into what you have in the background?
And it does come back to that whole thing of change.
Yeah,
you have to change what you're doing. So you have to ask yourself these questions first. You know, can I sustain this for the rest of my life? You know, as I always say, if you're a PT or if you're running a service that relies solely on yourself, you know, have you set up some residual income that, you know, after you stop working, there's still going to be something coming in?
Yeah.
You know, and you could still focus on your passion and making income that way. But you have to start asking yourself these questions, because I knew myself a few years back when I was working, I was making a lot of money, but I was working. Like,
yeah.
I was like, I used to always say I only watched ever one program. I was like Shameless. That was the only time, I didn't really want to watch TV, but I actually couldn't have if I wanted to, because I was just work. Whereas now I'm finding, right, I've left full-time employment now, so now I can have during the day free. Yes, I'm busy at evenings, but I want to be as well. I would rather be busy evenings, because if I came home at night, don't know what I would do. I would probably turn around and watch TV or, probably do a wee bit more reading and stuff, but I do what I do and I like it.
Yeah, I think it's important for people to evaluate what you're doing. So like we said, you need to change if you're stagnating I think if you don't notice that you need a change, then you probably do. Or even if you don't think you need a change, ask the people closest to you. Do you think I should do something different? Do you think I should try something? And more likely they'll tell you.
Or even on that too, just do it.
Yeah.
Just change something up. And again, if it doesn't work, so what? But ask yourself that question. Do I need to change?
So it's the lead up to Christmas now. There's a couple of days and it's going to be Christmas Day. So for the next 2 weeks, change is inevitable. You're going to have time to change because things are different for the next 2 weeks than they usually are during the rest of the year.
Yeah, so when you are doing it, one change could be you could sit and watch TV all day. You could sit and watch the movies and you could say it's you're recovering from your year of work. Or you could go, right, this is the perfect time for me to change my routine, to try something new. You know, I remember it was years ago, I like me surfing and we used to get in the water, but we got in the water around this time last year and it was so refreshing. And I actually took one of my mates up with me one time and said, just come. He's like, right, well, I'll give it a go. Loved it. Now he's hooked. You know, it was even a few years ago, I actually got my son a surfboard for Christmas and we went up straight in January. Just, again, a wee bit of a change of routine. We could have very easily stayed at home and watched TV.
Yeah.
But try something new. Get that change in and whatever it is for you, it doesn't really matter. Even if it's sitting at home reading a book, get that change in that you wouldn't normally do.
Thanks for listening to the Coaching Mindset Podcast. And Merry Christmas for the next coming days.
Yeah, and a Merry Christmas from me as well too. Just to remind you guys that our podcast goes out every Thursday at 6 o'clock. We would encourage you to share it with as many people as you can. Listen to it in the car, in your workout, anywhere at all. And as well too, if you get the chance, drop us a wee bit of feedback and see how you enjoyed it or any way we can improve it. So thank you very much and Merry Christmas.